Hi guys, welcome to lesson 2 on English Descriptive for NABARD as well as RBI Examination 2019. So if you have not seen the previous lecture, please go and watch that first, because the essay topics that I have discussed in that particular video are also important for the upcoming examination. And today I'm going to discuss a total of 3 topics, and the third topic is specific to the NABARD aspirants. Therefore, please watch the entire video so that you don't miss out on the third topic, which is one of the important topics for NABARD 2019. Okay, so let us start with the session. If you have not subscribed to the channel, do that immediately, specifically if you're preparing for upcoming NABARD or RBI examination, because that is going to help you in your preparation in a variety of ways. Okay, so let me move to the side, and right now you should be able to see a screen towards the left hand side. You can see that this is the English test 2, and in this particular test, although I have given a prezi, a comprehension, and at the same time some essay topics, but I'm going to discuss only the essay topics as of now, because the English test 2 is still underway. Okay, so the first topic that we have, the analysis that I'm going to do today, is what are the reasons behind NBFC crisis in India and how can it be resolved. Now, what did I tell you in the first lesson? I told you that first objective or first goal is to identify the important keywords that you're going to stick to before you start with an essay. So what are the keywords in this essay? What are the reasons behind NBFC crisis in India? So we are going to limit ourselves to India and not go into the global scenario. NBFC crisis in India and how can it be resolved? So we have to answer two things. What are the reasons for this crisis and how can it be resolved? So we have to talk about the problem, and we also have to talk about the solution. What are the solutions that we are providing to resolve this particular crisis, and how did this crisis come into place? Let's start with the reasons first, and then I will jump towards the solutions. Asset liability mismatch. You all must be aware about this particular reason. Very important, yet at the same time, everybody knows about it. So this is something that everyone is going to write. And so of course, although it is very important reason, but it is not going to fetch you any extra marks, because you know that everybody would also know this. NBFCs had borrowed short term from banks. So let's say an NBFC is there which borrows for, let's say, 3 years, but at the same time lends for, let's say, 20 years. So after 3 years, it has to give back whatever it has borrowed, but it has lent for 20 years, and at the same time, this lending that has been done for 20 years, the borrowers of this particular lending are going NPA, are not paying back interest or principal repayments in time. The reason we are going to discuss in a short while. So NBFCs borrowed short term from banks and mutual funds, while the lending to developers of long term projects was made, which got held up because of various factors. Now, the factors are not important here, because you have only 300 to 400 words. You have to limit yourself to the word limit, and therefore you're going to stick to the topic under discussion. So I hope the first point is clear. The second one is slowdown in infrastructure sector, which is strongly connected with the first point here. In the first point, you're talking about developers who had provided long-term or who had borrowed for long-term projects. Who were these developers? Basically, the infrastructure sector, whether the real estate, whether the road sector, whether, let's say, creation of airways, creation of strips, or creation of waterways. So all those infrastructure sectoral companies had borrowed from NBFCs, but they're unable to pay back to these NBFCs because of various slowdowns that are happening. So that is second reason. The third one is rising cost of borrowing. Now this is an impact of the crisis after it started, and this is further fueling the crisis. So this is like acting fuel to the fire, which has already taken place. The fire here is that NBFCs have not been able to pay back their loans in time. And what is the fuel? The fuel is that the cost of borrowing is now rising further for these NBFCs, and therefore, even if they wanted to come out of this issue, come out of this problem, they are unable to do it because the cost of borrowing are rising now. Let me go through it and we'll understand it better. Most banks have cleaned up their books and showed up balance sheets, but NBFCs which borrow from banks and mutual funds are in trouble. Their costs, particularly those of smaller ones, have shot up. Why have their costs shot up? Because let's say this was NBFC, it had borrowed from a bank on a short term and it had lent to, let's say, infra projects or various other projects for long term. Now these banks, because of crisis here, the banks said, or the banks thought, oh my god, now we might not get our money back, let's increase the interest rate that we demand from these NBFCs, because now the risk of default for the loans made to NBFCs is higher. Higher the risk, higher the reward that you need. Therefore, the percentage interest rate demanded by these banks has also gone up. What does it mean? It means that the cost of borrowing for these NBFCs has gone up. How are they going to trade off? How are they going to transfer it or make sure that they're making profits? They will transfer the cost to these lenders, to these borrowers, sorry, to whom NBFCs are going to lend further by increasing the percentage of interest rate that they charge from these infrastructure companies or to any borrower who makes borrowing from these NBFCs. Okay, so that's what's written here. Their costs, particularly those of smaller ones, have shot up and they don't have money to lend. Banks want NBFCs to promise higher returns on the loans they buy from them. The squeeze at the NBFC end and the consequently higher interest rates could hurt the construction sector, auto and jewelry firms. Why? Because they are the ones borrowing heavily from NBFCs. But now NBFCs say, hey, I was lending you at 7%, but now my costs have gone up, so I'm going to lend you at no less than 8%. So now the cost for these companies also goes up. And some data is given which proves this particular point. So this is an impact and at the same time something which is acting as a reinforcement of this crisis, making it more worse. Okay, these are the three major reasons which are important or which resulted into the NBFC crisis. Now what are the solutions that you can give? Number one is increase the liquidity in the system. Now here is a controversy, or here is a difference in opinion, because RBI says that liquidity is enough in the system now, but banks and NBFC says that we don't have enough liquidity, we want more money in the system. When liquidity is less, then the cost of borrowing is more, because money is more valuable, right? Money is more valuable. Instead of 100 rupees, there is only 50 rupees in the market. So now whoever holds that 50 rupees says, hey, there is limited money in the economy, I'm going to lend you these 50 rupees only if you pay me 10% rather than 5%. You say, okay, there is no choice, the money in the economy is less, I need money, I will have to pay you 10% instead of 5%. So this is how cost of borrowing goes up when the money in the economy or liquidity in the economy is less. So this is where NBFCs say that liquidity in the system is still less. Second is, we need to deepen the debt markets to facilitate long-term availability of capital in projects. Now what it means is that we need to structure and at the same time encourage or promote the debt markets so that these long-term projects, companies which are involved in long-term projects, can borrow from the debt market instead of going through these NBFCs. So there's another method of borrowing from the market. And at the same time, the NBFCs, instead of relying on banks, can also go to the debt market and borrow from the debt markets by asking the investors themselves to act as creditors. What is the debt market? Debt market is where you issue certain bonds or debentures and various other credit instruments and you borrow from people directly. So NBFCs as well as the long-term project holders can go to the debt market and borrow for long term directly from the debt market instead of making that asset liability mismatch that we talked about by borrowing on short term and lending on long term. Okay, so this is a very important point. The third point that we have is to set up a strong regulatory system for alternative investment funds. Now, this is very important. Alternative investment funds don't have a separate regulatory system. They are regulated by either IRDAI, if they are insurance companies, or RBI or SEBI in certain cases. But there is no separate regulatory system for alternative investment funds. So, it says that we need to create a separate regulatory system for AIFs, so that which is risk based rather than universal for all kinds of financial institutions. So, rather than creating universal policies for all these different NBFCs, we create risk based policies, because if you have an independent and separate regulatory system which is specific to AIFs, it is going to focus more on its development, on its better regulation. Okay, so that's what third solution can be, which is basically the future on how the alternate investment funds market can look in the future. And the fourth one is also a futuristic solution, which says that in the insurance space, again, we need to introduce risk-based solvency. So, insurance companies are also NBFCs. They are not banks, and they are also NBFCs because they are also lending or investing in the financial markets. So, these NBFCs should be based on risk-based solvency, wherein the value of these insurance companies is dependent upon the risk that they are taking while investing in the financial markets and while borrowing from different platforms, rather than creating a universal risk-based system for them. Okay, so this is a little technical. You can just mention that we should have a risk-based solvency. Solvency means the ability of a firm to survive, to be solvent, not to go bankrupt in the future. So, risk-based solvency means that their solvency should be based upon the risks, different kinds of risks that they are taking, so that a true comparison across insurance companies based on their financial strength when it comes to solvency can be made more effectively. Okay, so this is specific to the insurance sector, which is also one of the NBFCs. So this was all about the first topic. I hope you found it important. Let's come to the second topic. The second topic is draft e-commerce policy. Is it the future of data-based economy in India? Now, what is the first thing that you're going to do? The first thing is identify the keywords. What are the keywords here? Draft e-commerce policy, number one, national e-commerce policy. And is it the future of data-based economy in India? Is it the future? So they're asking us a question. This is another keyword here. Is it the future? We are going to say yes, it is the future for these reasons, and no, it is not the future for these reasons of a data-based economy in India. So a particular introduction that I found important, something that I found online in an article, I wrote it, changed some things, wrote it myself. An analogy has been made in this particular introduction. This is to tell you that analogies can also be used to actually explain what you're trying to say. The analogy here is comparison of oil with data, a data-based economy. It is almost a cliche today that data is the new oil. Just like oil has driven a majority of the economies around the world for the past 7 to 8 decades, data is that new oil. Unlike in the case of oil, data flows freely across borders. It can be stored or processed abroad, and the processor can appropriate all the value. So the value can be transferred to the person who has access to the data immediately, as soon as the access to the data transfers to the receiver. Therefore, India's data should be used for country's development. Because it is freely transferable, we should not allow it to go out of our hands, because then the oil that we have in the form of data is gone. Okay? And Indian citizens and companies should get the economic benefits from monetization of data, which is the new oil. So this is how an analogy brings out the importance of data by putting it equal to oil. Let's now come to the points as to how, yes, data is the future of a data-based economy, or draft e-commerce policy is the future of a data-based economy, and how, no, it is not the future of a data-based economy in India because of the problems with the draft national policy, draft e-commerce policy. So, first we will talk about the yeses, or how it is the future, and then we will talk about how it is not the future. So these are the three points that I have mentioned in favor of draft e-commerce policy. Yes, considering data as national asset might promote it similar to communication sector in India, which uses bandwidth from satellites while it is considered as a national asset. Now, this is one important feature of draft e-commerce policy, because it puts or it considers or it recommends that data should be considered as a national asset, just like bandwidth is considered as a national asset, just like a lot of other things like coal, etc., have been considered as a national asset. So it says that data should also be considered as a national asset in a similar manner. So it says, the argument says, yes, it is the future of a data-based economy in India, because just like other various other assets like bandwidth, like coal, like oil, have been considered as national assets and have been used for development in the economy, data should also be considered the same and should be used for development in the economy in the future. So this argument also maintains the flow that we started in the introduction by putting oil or by putting data equivalent to the new oil. So the flow is maintained because that connection is made between the introduction and the first point of body paragraph. Let's come to the second point of yes, it is the future. Establishment of an independent data authority, this is the second point which the draft e-commerce policy provides. Of course, if you're thinking that how would I know what are the points under draft e-commerce policy, well, that is something that you have to know, and this is what I made sure through Prezi of English Test 1. So the Prezi was not completely focused on just, you know, helping you how to understand a Prezi, how to write a Prezi. It was also made kept in mind that you should read about draft e-commerce policy, because that's also an important topic. Establishment of an independent data authority will ensure regulation of data, which will be the driving force for Indian economy in the future. I think very simple to understand. Yes, setting up infrastructure for data storage in India. So the draft policy also says that if we want to set up that backend infrastructure for data, we need to keep that data within the confines of our economy. Okay, because if the data goes out, the need to set up infrastructure to store that data is also not required anymore. So it says that if you want to create jobs, if you want to set up a good infrastructure system which is going to secure that data and keep it within the confines of Indian economy and be used for development of the economy, you need to have you need to consider it as a national asset, and you need to regulate it. And then there are the arguments of no, it is not the future. The e-commerce policy is not the future of a data-based economy. Number one, it is a protectionist move, because as I discussed in the previous lesson on English, G4 Globalization 4 talks about interconnectivity based on digital services and digital products. But the e-commerce policy goes completely against that, because it is a protectionist move which will reduce global competition in setting a digital economy in India. Just assume and just think what will happen if data is confined to Indian economy. No data will go out and the foreign data will stop coming in. So the global competition in setting up a digital economy, in terms of foreign companies coming into India and setting up digital services centers in India, will also be demolished. Lack of competition will drive out innovation and come in the way of making India a data-based economy. I think it's self-explanatory here. What is the second point? Access of data to government and political parties will empower them. So this is about misuse of data by the political parties, by the government, for their own uses, for their own advantages. And therefore, a data-based undemocratic economy is not the future we want. Therefore, data should not be considered a national asset. Instead, it should be allowed to flow freely into the system. So these are the points, and I think 5 points are more than enough. If you are writing an essay of 300 to 400 words, you don't need more points than that. And at the same time, this ensures that your answer is multidimensional. First is we talking about national asset, then we talk about another feature, that is independent data authority, then we talk about infrastructure, then we talk about how it is not the future we want by mentioning protectionism and by mentioning misuse. So it is talking about different dimensions, right? It is not sticking to one particular dimension. Now this is the third topic that we have for today, and this is very important specifically for candidates, and majority of the students preparing for RBI examination are preparing for NABARD as well. So this one is very important for those guys. The topic is green revolution to evergreen revolution. What are the important changes required in Indian agriculture to make it productive and efficient? What are the keywords here? Number one, green revolution. Number two, evergreen revolution. Number three, changes required. Number four, to make it productive and efficient. These are the major keywords. Of course, we're talking about agriculture in the entire topic, so we don't need to highlight that as a keyword. Okay, so you need to keep in mind and understand what are the words that are to be considered as keywords. Only then will you be able to strike at the central theme of the essay. Okay, that is what is important. So the question says, while we are moving from green revolution to evergreen revolution, what are the changes we need to make in this new policy, in this new step, in this new initiative that we are taking, starting from green, learning from the mistakes that we made and not making the same mistakes again in evergreen revolution, if we want to make agriculture more productive and efficient? What are the changes that you feel should be taken? Think from both government's point of view and from the consumer's point of view. From a layman's point of view, what do you think is it that the Indian agriculture needs? Before moving on to the points, let us frame some of those points. Number one, farmers. Okay, farmers are the ones which have not been able to flourish in the past 7 decades, and therefore we need to focus a lot on them. Number two, agriculture is still dependent heavily on monsoons. So we need to move out of that. So the infrastructure that we need in order to ensure that agriculture stays a stable profession for the farmers, we need to invest in infrastructure, and at the same time R&D also comes into play. Third is green revolution to evergreen revolution. What were the problems with the green revolution that we need to learn and not make the same mistakes again? The main problem was monoculture. We need to ensure that we don't fall into the same trap by taking steps that we are diversifying our agriculture. At the same time, we need to focus on agro processing. Now this is where your knowledge of Niti Aayog report that I had discussed will come into play. I talked about Niti Aayog's vision of agro processing in India and how agro processing can ensure inflow of entrepreneurs into the agriculture sector. The same can be mentioned here. So this is how your understanding of, or a better understanding of Niti Aayog report will help you out immensely in the essays as well. And there are a lot of more points which we're going to talk about. So once you have mentioned, once you have figured out the topics that are going to, the points that you're going to write, you start with them. The first one is that I just said, focus on farmers. And this goes with the idea or the objective of doubling farmers' income by 2022. Doubling farmers' income by 2022. Because till now the focus has been completely on agriculture and the consumer, but we have missed out or we have ignored the farmer. This is where this particular change from green to evergreen becomes useful. Focus on local production and local distribution. This is against monoculture, and at the same time mono distribution, you can call it, or you can call it something which is produced in Andhra Pradesh should be produced in Andhra Pradesh is now being produced in Punjab as well. Because it is lucrative or it is considered to be highly paying. So we need to focus on local production and local distribution. And at the same time, we need to focus on the supply chains so that the waste that we generate, which is almost 30 to 35% of whatever food crops we produce, is also reduced. So we need to focus on this And at the same time, we need to focus on local production and local distribution, because that ensures that agriculture is sustainable in nature. Okay. For example, if we produce rice in Punjab, or if we produce rice in western areas of UP where water is already less, then we are going to suffer. Just like sugarcane is being produced in the western parts of the of Uttar Pradesh, although because of irrigation facilities the crops are doing well, but at the same time this is not the normal or the natural place of growing sugarcane anymore. So it is not sustainable in nature. Okay. The third point is the focus on sustainability, that is soil health, quality of seeds, usage of the correct usage of various chemicals or fertilizers. That also needs to be the focus if we want to make our agriculture production productive and at the same time efficient in the long run. The fourth point is creating agriculture climate resilient. This is highly dependent upon these factors that have already been sorted out before. Fifth one is research and education in agriculture. The number of universities that are there in agriculture, number of research institutions in agriculture are still very less. We need to focus more on those areas and ensure that the youth is driven towards the agriculture. How many companies do you see working in the field of agriculture, or how many young minds do you see willing to get into agriculture? Very less. If you are educated, you want to get into the services sector. You don't want to get your hands dirty by getting into agriculture. Okay, we need to change that. And that can be done only through skill development, education, and enough research in the field of agri. Monoculture to multiple agriculture that I had mentioned based on features of the location. Penetration of advanced technologies in agriculture. It is still limited to tractors. In fact, many of the areas do not even have tractors. But if you go to areas like, Europe or Australia, New Zealand, you go to US, you see one farmer taking care of hundreds of acres. How? Due to machineries, due to advanced machineries, due to advanced technologies. That is not available in India. So that results in disguised unemployment, and at the same time, that also reduces the productivity. Formalization of agriculture to make it a part of formal economy. It is still not a part of formal economy. Majority of the farmers, more than 80% of the farmers, are small and marginal farmers. And these are the farmers who are not a part of the formal economy, whether it's bank accounts, whether it's insurance. These are the very basic things. A formal economy is much more than that. Social security is not available to these farmers. They're not able to have a good quality of life. So all these are not available to these kind of small and marginal farmers, which form a majority of our farming community in India. Okay. So these are the major points we have. I have discussed, I think, 8 points here. This makes it the 8th point. And I think these are enough for you to gather good marks if this kind of topic or something similar to this comes in the examination. Let me tell you, last year, we discussed about 30-35 topics, and out of that, one topic directly came in the examination that helped a lot of students. So this year also, I'm going to focus on that to a certain extent, probably come out with 20-30 topics specific to agriculture, and at the same time, some other areas as well, so that you're simultaneously preparing for RBI as well. And we'll make sure that whatever we prepare comes in the examination, so that you don't have to put that effort and you're well prepared when you start writing your essay. Okay. If you like this lesson, please subscribe to the channel. I hope you liked it. You can press the bell icon also in order to get notifications, because I'm going to come out with videos on a daily basis specifically for NABARD now. Okay. All the very best. Take care.